Good morning. Welcome to CATEX-TV. My name is Frank Fortunato. This is a live broadcast from Princeton, New Jersey. Today is Thursday, June 10th, 2010. It's 11:30 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time in the U.S. It's 4:30 p.m. in London. In Hamilton, Bermuda, 12:30 p.m. In Mexico City, 10:30. If you need to reach us during the broadcast, please phone in toll-free at 1-866-67-CATEX. Overseas, our AOL instant mail address is CATEX-TV. Britain's Prince Philip, the husband of the Queen, is 89 years old today. He's probably reading the Daily Racing Form right now. Here's a very interesting story I just was handed before I walked into the studio. It's coming from Insurance Insider. I will read it to you. The headline is Brit Silent on Bid Approach. Brit Insurance has not responded to a request for comment on suggestions that it recently received a takeover approach. The Insurance Insider understands that the Brit board met earlier this week where the approach was discussed. According to sources close to the company, the board gathered this week to discuss an unsolicited takeover bid request. Very interesting. Out of our May news. In the U.S., the stock market's up. It's up about 222 points right now, and part of the reason is this jobs report. The tally of laid-off workers continuing to claim jobless benefits fell by the largest amount in almost a year, suggesting that more unemployed workers may be finding work. At the same time, new claims for unemployment insurance dipped slightly for the third straight week. The Labor Department said that the total unemployment benefit rolls fell by 255,000 to a seasonally adjusted 4.5 million. This is the lowest total since December of 2008. Well, you knew this was coming. Here is George Schneider. He's the chief financial officer of Munich Re. He said that their previously avowed target of a net gain in excess of 2 billion euros in 2010 is looking increasingly ambitious. He was speaking at a conference in Madrid hosted by Goldman Sachs. He said that the target rate of a 15% return on risk-adjusted capital over the cycle could be maintained, but that the 97% combined ratio target in reinsurance was, quote, presumably not achievable this year. Of course, that follows the earthquake in Chile and windstorm Xynthia in Europe. As we reported on Monday, Munich Re increased its estimated loss as a result of the quake in Chile up to 1 billion euros from 700 million euros. He also said that the 5.2% return on investment achieved in Q1 was not sustainable for the rest of 2010. He said the full year expectation is less than 4%. However, the gross premium income target of between 43 billion and 45 billion was confirmed. I wonder whether or not they're maintaining the strict underwriting discipline they're famous for, if they're maintaining that gross premium income target. That's an interesting question. Well, there's a report floating around the United States today coming from a congressional panel. AIG's bailout had a, quote, poisonous effect on the U.S. financial system because it showed that the American government would protect Wall Street firms from their own risk-taking. The Federal Reserve could have acted earlier, according to the report, to find a privately funded solution for AIG. This is all coming from an entity called the Congressional Oversight Panel. One of the things that the oversight panel spoke about was the role of Secretary Geithner. This is the comment from Elizabeth Warren, who's the chairperson of the panel. I'll read it to you in their entirety. The government's actions in rescuing AIG continue to this day to have a poisonous effect on the marketplace. The AIG rescue demonstrated that Treasury and the Federal Reserve would commit taxpayers to pay any price, bear any burden, to prevent the collapse of America's largest financial institutions and to assure repayment to the creditors doing business with them. The rescue helped prevent an utter collapse of the economy, according to Geithner, back when he was the president of the New York Federal Reserve Bank in 2008. Lawmakers, of course, called the AIG bailout a backdoor bailout because Goldman Sachs, Societe Generale, and others receive full payment of their derivative contracts courtesy of the U.S. taxpayer. One of the points that the panel makes is that the Federal Reserve Bank and the Treasury essentially, in the wake of the Lehman crisis, just the very next day, were forced to deal with AIG, and the deal that they gave them was too sweet. Andrew Williams, a Treasury spokesman who reports now to Secretary Geithner, says that the report, quote, overlooks the basic fact that the global economy was on the brink of collapse, and there were only hours in which to make crucial decisions. Since then, we've learned and have been fighting for more than a year now to give the government authority to put firms like AIG out of existence when their failure poses a danger to our economic system. Those are good points. If people remember back to the way things were then, you'll recognize that it was hour to hour. Just for the record, AIG owes about $26 billion on a credit line to the government and $49 billion additionally to the Treasury. The company returned to profit in the first quarter of this year. Their CEO, Robert Ben Mosh, in late May told this congressional panel, I'm confident you'll get your money back plus a profit. We're a strong, vibrant company. Well, British Petroleum may be able to kill all the pelicans, dolphins, and other wildlife in the Gulf of Mexico, but their investors can sure escape, and are they running to the hills right now? Their share price continues to plunge. Shares in the company plunged again today in London. There was another big sell-off yesterday in New York, wiped out more than $82 billion in value from the London-based firm. BP is number 5 worldwide in the Forbes list of biggest companies, and now in the 52nd day of the spill, their shares have fallen more than 40%. And there has been chatter, as we noted yesterday, about a possible bankruptcy filing by BP because of American political pressure on the company to halt dividend payments and pay even more compensation for the Gulf spill. The President of the United States yesterday called on Tony Hayward to extend unemployment benefits to thousands of American workers who have been put out of work because of the spill. The big sell-off yesterday and today in London came after well-respected oil analyst Matt Simmons told Fortune magazine that he expects a bankruptcy filing by BP within a month. Quote, they're going to run out of cash from lawsuits, cleanups, and other expenses. Wow. Imagine if you had bought BP short about 52 days ago. My God. We'll go to a word from our sponsors and come back with the rest of the news. In the U.S., we have a company called Best Buy, which is dotting the landscape with huge stores selling things electronic, everything from huge flat-screen TVs to computers to audio equipment. The U.K. has a similar entity called Currys. It's a big electronic retailer. Well, Currys has purchased an insurance policy with Lloyd's to cover its own policy to refund £10 to purchasers of high-end TVs for every goal that England scores in the World Cup, excluding, of course, its own goals and penalty shootouts. The FT is reporting this. Currys should pay about £60 to every purchaser of big TVs based on past English football history. The company will not disclose what it expects its total liability might be, but it's hedged it through a Lloyd's of London policy. Andrew Buchanan, the head of accounting at BDO, said the event could wreak